Colin Kola with GrowingYourGreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you, and where we're at today is on a field trip here in Northern California. We're at a friend's house. Actually, she just moved into this new place here, and I've actually come over to give her a free garden consult. So I don't normally give garden consults to people because I get people email me all the time, John, come over and do a garden consult, man. Sorry, I just don't do this. I do this for good friends, and you know, this is a good friend here. So what we're gonna do today is go around her place, kind of show you and give you my opinions on maybe what she might want to grow and some of the ways that she might want to do it. The first thing that I like to say is that, you know, when you move into any place, you want to notice some of the different, you know, existing plants that are growing. So right here, we have actually some a cactus growing. This is known as an Nepal cactus. It's actually just a spineless variety, probably the Luther Burbank variety. It's been here quite a bit of time. And so these guys are edible. And if I was to harvest these to eat them, I would harvest the young little small baby pads, and probably a little more tender than the older mature ones. And then as you guys can see, if we look closely up here, we got some cactus fruit forming. Now these guys do have some little spikes on there, and but they're gonna be definitely good once they're fully ripe. And I'll be definitely juicing those guys up. Now, one of the things to consider is when you move into a new place, you know, you don't know what they've sprayed on the ground. You don't know if they put, you know, chemical fertilizers, pesticides, herbicides, or anything. Looks pretty natural here, like most people didn't do much here. But, you know, one of the things I would do is I would actually start to feed some of the existing plants here. So, including the cactus, I mean, cactus needs nutrition too. I'd probably foliar feed some kind of compost tea to these guys. And also, you know, put some good stuff around the soil, including the rock dust and worm castings, and also the compost tea. So let's go and walk around some of the areas of the front yard and share with you a few other edible crops already growing. Just a few more edibles around the property. Here's one right here, one of my favorite greens. And if you go to France, they sell a certain variety of this actually as a salad green. They actually, in France, it's called buckhorn plantain, and I've grown that for edible uses because it's more the frou-frou variety of a leafy green. But this is just your standard plantain. Plantain is often used in, you know, medicine, herbal medicine and whatnot. But it's also a leafy green. I like to harvest them when they're younger. And actually, when this does go to flower and seed, the seeds actually, the husk of the seeds are known as the psyllium seeds. So if you have some problems going to the bathroom, save some of your plantain seeds. Now another cool edible that's growing in a few places here is this guy. This is actually the rosemary. And rosemary's drought tolerant, so it doesn't surprise me that this guy is doing quite well with being neglected, frankly. And besides using the rosemary like in recipes and seasoning different things, I want to remind you guys that the little rosemary flowers here, you can just pick the flowers here, and you know, you could sprinkle the flowers on you know, different salads and different things to make them look pretty, but also they have a nice mild rosemary flavor that's delish. So here's yet one of those cactuses. Looks like it's got a few spikes on there. There's some fruit forming. But I always want to encourage you guys to, you know, instead of look up at the sun and the sky, look down and look what we got here. This is actually one of the cactus fruits that was probably from last year. And be very careful, man. There's some spikes on here. But I could probably save some of this, although half of it's kind of like, you know, rotten on the inside. I'll probably cut off the bad part and eat the inside. It looks like this is actually a very healthy specimen. This is actually a quite large cactus fruit. I don't normally see them this large, so that's really cool. So I definitely want to add some nutrition to give this plant what it needs, so hopefully it could ramp up and produce more. Cactus fruits are one of my favorite fruits. They're not super sweet, but they're really rich in, you know, antioxidants and phytochemicals and phytonutrients. They have a lot of seeds, which are edible. So my favorite way to use them is to actually juice them to remove the seeds and drink the fresh, delicious cactus juice. Now, besides the cactus here, we got a couple more trees here in the background. And they look to me like they're some kind of fruit trees. And actually, if we look here at this one, you can see it's actually starting to fruit here. And there's just a lot of little fruits on there. So, you know, to me, that might look like it's, I don't know, maybe a cherry or something like that, because there's a lot of fruits. Like, normally other stone fruits wouldn't be like that. And you know, the state of this tree, it definitely looks like it's pretty old, you know, and there's like stuff growing on it and stuff, and it doesn't look like it's in the best of health. So if it was me and I lived here, what I'd do is, once again, You know, we want to get out the rock dust. We want to feed the soil with some rock dust. And we want to get the microbes back into the soil using the compost teas like that. And foliar feed the tree with the compost tea too to hopefully get some nutrition uptake. Also, I would also, put in some irrigation systems out here because it doesn't look like there's any irrigation. So this tree basically gets water a lot in the winter, and then in the summer, unless somebody remembers the water, it doesn't get watered much. And in general, when you're watering the trees, you want to look how far the branches go out, and it looks like this was probably pruned back a bunch. And you know, you don't want to just water at the base, you want to, you know, water a whole area so that the water could soak down and get to all the whole root zone here. Looks like we got a couple more trees over here and a lot of brush. It looks like we got maybe some kind of almond tree, and over there there's a persimmon tree. And you know, all these trees are pretty much in the same state of health, in my opinion. They're not looking super vibrant, super healthy, and that's because they've simply been neglected. So you know, if you take care of the property that you're on, no matter where you live, you can ramp up the production and get more production out of the trees. I mean, I went to a place, my friend's place in Portland, where they had a 100-year-old apple tree, and it never really did much. The apples were mealy and old and messed up until they started actually composting with wood chips and added rock dust. So one of the things I would do also is, besides adding the rock dust and the compost tea, is also add the fungal dominated compost, which is basically wood chip compost. You take a pile of wood chips, set them out, and let them compost down for a couple years, and then you're gonna have some really rich black gold, you know, that's gonna feed your trees. Another thing is that my friend here has a lot of space here. So no, I would use the space to my advantage, or hopefully she will to her advantage, and do something with it. You know, she could just let this be natural like this, but what I would do is I would get tree services that, you know, get wood chips, have them dump the wood chips, and I just start have them piling on wood chips and cover the ground with wood chips. This will, number one, keep the weeds down so they won't have to mow or cut or anything, because that's a lot of maintenance here. But also just keep piling it up, and over time those wood chips will degrade and build new soil. I always encourage you guys, no matter whether you bought a place or you're renting, you know, leave the soil better than when you found it. And by importing wood chips and letting them sit and rot, and this may take a couple, 3 years to do it, you're gonna leave the place better than you found it. And I think we should all do that here on Mother Earth. All right, so we're about to go in the backyard and show you guys, you know, probably the best space to plant a raised bed garden. While she could do it out here, we are out, you know, pretty much in nature, and I'm sure there's wildlife and other things out here that'll come and eat the garden. So a lot of the things I see out here, you know, it'd be hard for deer or other animals to eat. So it'd be better to do it behind a protected fence like this. But as I was walking in the backyard, I saw something right here. I mean, we got a couple things here that are edible, you know. So besides just the edible trees, like the thistle, these are edible, although they'll definitely prick you. You could juice those guys up. And over here, we got something really cool. This is a mint. So, you know, when you move in a new place, you know, you might want to get some guidebooks on wild edibles and just other common edibles. I know a lot of wild and mostly common edibles myself. My grandma used to have this mint on her farm, actually. Wow, it's quite good. Make a delicious smoothie. All you need to do is take some coconut water, some bananas, some mint, and maybe some green powder. One of my favorite breakfasts. Anyway, let's go ahead and continue in the backyard and share with you guys what my friend should do. So going in the backyard, I don't want to give you guys a wild food tour or nothing, but you know, here's another really cool crop that's growing already as a weed that can be eaten as a leafy green. Another one of my favorites. This is more of a ground mallow here, because it's not growing erect like the varieties I grow. But these leaves can be used for juicing, also salads and green smoothies. And there's some other weeds that are probably edible, but I'm not too familiar with. But in the backyard, you know, once again, we got more cactuses that are starting to grow some small baby pads, which would be good to eat in a little bit, and maybe some fruits. And also in the backyard, there's like a whole collection of rocks, you know, so rocks and some urbanite, or basically busted up concrete. So, you know, I want to have you guys use the resources you have on site. I mean, here's a whole bunch of rocks here that can be used to line up raised beds. You know, why buy wood? Why bring in stuff when you got things like this that you could arranged around to make a raised bed. And actually, that's what they've been doing over here, looks like. Maybe it's occupants, maybe just stacked up a bunch of stones, made a little circle here. And this could be made into a raised bed quite simply and easily. So, you know, I always want to encourage you guys to do the least amount of work and get the most amount of return. So if already somebody already done the work here, why not just go with it, man? So what I would do in this is I'd probably like, oh man, look, one of my favorite edibles right here growing. This is really valuable. It's not growing much else, probably because it's a protected area. This is actually known as the miner's lettuce. So right now it's actually going to seed. And if you want miner's lettuce seeds, we could probably get some out here. Oh, there they are. There's one. There's two little miner's lettuce seeds right there. So man, because there's miner's lettuce in here, oh, and there's some on the outside too. You know, this is one of my favorite edible, you know, greens here. When the miners came to California to harvest the gold, you know, they didn't have standard lettuce that you and I know, but they had the miner's lettuce growing, and that's why they call it miner's lettuce, because the miners would eat this just like lettuce, and actually it's quite good. It's going out of season, it's finishing up now since we are in the springtime, and it's soon to disappear because it grows in the cooler season of the year. But yeah, lots of miner's lettuce in here, which is really cool. If it was me, I'd probably wait another week and then harvest all these guys and get all the seeds out and save them so I could replant them and spread them around later on. So what I would do in this raised bed is I'd probably move out some of these rocks in the middle, and then I'd probably put down like three or four layers of cardboard. So just cardboard on the bottom, because this is a basically area that's been untouched, ungrown in. There's a lot of weeds in this backyard, so we got to put down like three or four layers of cardboard, and then basically maybe make the wall a little bit better, and then pile it in with dirt. And pile up dirt, I don't know, I'd probably go at least 8 inches to a foot high all the way around. Looks like you might have to rebuild the wall on one side. And then you'll have a whole bed of dirt ready to grow. So let's talk about the soil. What are we going to fill this with? So here in Sonoma County, I would recommend using Sonoma compost. And if you just had to get one of their products, I would use the Mallard Plus. It's actually quite affordable. I don't know, maybe like, I don't know, $25, $30 a cubic yard. And that's inexpensive. While somebody could go to a landscape supply store and pay $80, $100 a yard, you know, why waste extra money? I'd much rather you guys spend the money, you know, instead of buying a $100 product, you know, buy a $25 product that'll do the same thing. You get four times as much, so you can have four times as much soil and grow four times as much food. I have 100% confidence that the soil or compost from Sonoma Compost works great, because that's the very soil I've been using for many years now. Now we're looking at a palm here. It's actually a special kind of palm. It just got planted here, actually. It's probably about 5 years old now, but this thing in about, I don't know, 50 years will be huge. It'll probably be like this big around and be a huge palm tree that's gonna produce some coconut-like little fruits. It's called the Jubea or Chilean wine palm. Be sure to check my past episodes on the Chilean wine palm. It's a palm that will grow excellent here in Northern California and produce little coconut-like fruits that actually taste like a coconut. I have a good episode on that myself. So because this just got planted, I would definitely, you know, enrich the soil in the area, put down a good layer of compost, rock dust, and some worm castings to help give it the nutrition it needs so that it can thrive. So another resource you guys have already existing in your place in most cases is a fence. You know, I particularly like these kind of wire fences like this, because to me, I don't see a fence that keeps the dogs in. What I see is a trellis. It's a free trellis, because it's already here. You don't even got to put it up, right? It's already here. So what I would do is I would, you know, run a drip line along the whole perimeter of the fence, and then maybe make either a little raised bed or just pile soil up along the edge of the fence here. And I'd plant things like pole beans and beans, and I'd plant multicolor heirloom ones, green, yellow, and purple, and have those coming up this whole fence, so it'll provide some privacy, but also provide a lot of food. But also, you know, all the food growing up this will be able to grow up it and, you know, stay up it on its own without you having to do anything, and you'll make more and better use of the vertical growing space. Of course, that being said, because this is kind of a more wild area, I'd probably clear both sides of the fence, you know, out a couple feet, because otherwise the weeds might take over and suck the nutrients out of your compost and all the good soil you're bringing in. to grow your vegetables up the fence. One of the big things that's really important to be successful in your garden is, in my opinion, have an irrigation system. This is a little hose bib that's in the front yard that has to get run to a hose to the backyard to be able to water things. And you know, if you just, you know, invested a lot of money in your garden and solely relied on this to grow your food and get your plants watered, you know, I think that'd be a fatal error. You know, sometimes people are traveling, things get busy, you know, and it'd be much better to install an irrigation system. So how I would do that if I lived at this place is, we got all this water coming out the front here, and actually this is just PVC that's been painted. You know, it's probably not super secure, but they just got a Y coming off here. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna go ahead and follow this pipe into the backyard, maybe put a spigot in the backyard as well as tee off, and maybe make some kind of standard lawn irrigation system with the valves to go out to different areas of the garden. So I'm following this pipe, and it looks like this pipe goes over to here. So somewhere in the neighborhood of over here, what I'd do is I'd cut this pipe right here, and then I'd tee off. And then I'd probably put another spigot here so I know I could have an outlet or water in the backyard that's controllable. But besides that, I'd go into the irrigation system with standard like Hunter PGP valves that are available at Home Depot, and probably have like three different valves, you know, maybe one for the periphery of the fence line, one for the raised beds, you know, on one side of the yard, and one for the other side of the yard. And I'd probably even maybe run something to the trees on another valve too, and then have a controller box to control all that stuff. Now, yes, this is definitely some work, but I think if you install it right the first time, it's gonna offer you a higher probability and better chance of success in the long run. If you need to know how to do this kind of irrigation stuff, be sure to check my other episodes. I have plenty of episodes on irrigation. If you go to growingyourgreens.com, click on the little magnifying glass, and then you just, it'll bring up the search box. You can search my videos for irrigation, and it'll show, you know, how to do some of this work if you've never done it before. One of the things you want to realize when you're going to place your raised bed is, how much sun does the space get? Like, with all this area that's here at my friend's yard, I mean, there's no reason why she should be growing in the shade unless she wants to grow some delicate plants that need shade, and she could put them behind the house. But as you guys can see, there's a lot of different trees overhanging into the yard and on the property. So it would behoove her to maybe, you know, come out every day and kind of look at different times of the day where the sun is, what's being shaded out, so that she could place her raised beds in a place that's not shaded out and gets the least amount of shade during the day. It should be no problem to find, you know, good sunny spots all day long with so much open space. Now we're walking around the back side of the house. We're on the side of the house, which actually is a nice sunnier spot, and that's probably the area that I'd focus on first because it does get more sun. Here in the back, it looks like the house is shading out, and although it does get into more sun, what we got here is a few things. We got a nice patio area, so I just leave the patio area for seating. But also, it looks like we got some established raised beds. So, you know, one of the things I want to say is, you know, with the rocks, because they are established, and it'd be a pain in the butt to move the rocks and move them to somewhere else. If you wanted them somewhere else, I'd probably leave them. But with these guys, it looks like some, you know, raised beds made out of some lumber here. And you could pick these up and move them if you wanted to. So, you know, don't just let the raised beds that are existing in your yard dictate where they're going to be. If you want to move them somewhere else, maybe to the other side of the yard, for example, and have all your garden stuff over there and have this as a nice hangout area. Another thing to be aware of is, you know, other edible plants. So like right to the side here, I'm looking at the blackberries, and it looks like there's a bunch of blackberries in this area. And soon enough, there'll be some blackberries on here, but these are nice and thorny. And one thing about the blackberries is that they are invasive. So if you, you know, put a raised bed garden here, it's highly probable that the blackberries will get underneath your raised bed garden, come up, and, you know, in a few years, you're just gonna have a raised bed garden full of blackberries. So for me personally, I'd probably end up moving this guy and leaving the blackberry patch on its own, and then I'll have some blackberries to make blackberry smoothies in the summertime. But with these raised beds, once again, you know, wherever I move them, I'd do the similar thing. I'd probably put three or four layers of cardboard down, because it looks like we do got a lot of weeds in here. And if you just put one layer of cardboard, you know, they might grow through it. Or if you just lay dirt all over this, the stuff would continue to grow up. Let's talk about the soil that you're actually going to fill it up with. I talked about getting the compost, it's Sonoma compost, but besides just getting the compost, I'd add other things into the soil, such as my favorite things, such as the worm castings and the compost. I mean, yeah, you could add other stuff, but it could get kind of expensive. But these are some of the basics, I think, that are very important. So number one, the rock dust. So I'd get the azomite and the Gaia Green glacial rock dust that is available locally at Lee Ballister's in Santa Rosa. Per each yard of compost, I'd probably get 4 bags of the azomite and 2 bags or 3 bags of the Gaia Green glacial rock dust. And then I would also get 4 bags or 5 bags of the Worm Gold Plus worm castings from Friedman Brothers that's available locally. Mix those guys up all together, and then that's going to make up your soil blend. You could add other stuff too, but these are the baseline things that I'd recommend, trying to keep it on a budget because my friend doesn't have a super lot of money, but also to ensure that she's going to have good growing results. Aside from that, of course, I'd get compost tea to treat the soil with and actually also spray on the plants. That's also very important. But those are the bare minimums that I'd recommend. If you want more recommendations on what you can add to the soil, be sure to check out my other videos for all the other stuff that I use. It's, you know, probably not needed. Oh, last thing. This is the other thing that's really important to add. You need to add a product like the boogie humus, or basically broken down wood chip compost. And this can be hard and rare to find. I was able to find some in the Houston area, Texas, and here locally it's also sold as California humus or boogie humus, and those are the ones that I'd recommend locally. And I'd probably do minimum for each raised bed, I'd add 1 bag of the boogie humus into 1 raised bed to ignite the fire of the fungal dominated organisms that's living in the compost. One of the things that's going on here is that they got pets. They got 2 little cute dogs. Penny! Two little cute dogs. Oh, here's one dog. There's the other dog. Oh, he's trying to bite me. And they got a cat. So one of the challenges is when you plant a new raised bed, especially if you got cats, you know, they're going to think it's a new litter box for them. So they're going to dig in it, and they're going to poop in it. Dogs get in here and dig it up and ruin your beds and ruin your plants. So a really good and easy way to keep them out is kind of what they're doing here. They basically just put this wire stuff, you know, the fence stuff, over it to keep the animals out. I mean, they were actually composting in here. But this could easily be used to keep animals out when your plants are starting to grow before they're really big. Once your plants are really big, then most animals, unless they're trying to eat them, or most domestic pets, are not going to get into your beds. But until that time, you might want to have like some kind of cover over them, you know, with something like this stuff. Now next, let's talk about what should get planted. So we are here in April, and in April, this is the prime season now for starting to plant your summer garden. This area does get nice sun, and this area does get quite hot in the summertime. And so I'd recommend some of the crops. They're gonna do well here. Of course, the tomatoes are gonna do really well. The peppers are gonna do really well. Things like the cucumbers are gonna do really well. And Northern California is a nice, fairly mild climate. You grow all different kinds of cucumbers, you know. Also things like the squashes, you know, especially with all the trellis space up the fence that you guys saw earlier. I'd grow different kinds of beans, including runner beans, standard green beans. You know, I'd grow some, like vining squashes, maybe like some butternut or acorn squash, or you know, whatever winter squashes you'd like. I'd actually also grow the kakai pumpkins, one of my favorite pumpkins to grow, that's grown for the edible hullless seeds. Let's see, other things I'd grow probably for the leafy greens, I'd grow the dinosaur kale. The red Russian kale are going to do great in the nice hot summer here. Other things that can be grown at this time are, of course, at local nurseries. So one of the best nurseries in the area for a variety and wide variety of different crops that can be grown at present time is Harmony Farms in Sebastopol. They actually cost quite a pretty penny for what they sell there, but they're a good nursery and they have the widest varieties of crops. You know, some of the ones that I like the most that they offer are some of the Manzano or Rakoto peppers that can be overwintered, you know, inside. If you dig them up in my unheated greenhouse, they'll produce year-round, no problem. And they have a wide variety of peppers. Of course, everybody loves tomatoes. I personally like the cherry tomatoes, although any kind of tomato is going to do great in this weather. And besides that, if you're going to go for seeds, you want to check out rareseeds.com, which is the website of the Baker Creek Seed Company. They're located in Petaluma, California. They have all different kinds of heirloom seeds that you can purchase locally and grow. Now, aside from just these standard common summer crops or annual crops, I would also encourage, you know, having a bed or two of perennial crops. Perennial crops are the crops that you could literally plant once and they're gonna come back or grow year after year. So maybe I'd start growing some perennial artichokes, for example, some perennial purple tree collards. You know, those are definitely some good ones to start out with. I love the tree collards, probably one of my favorite perennial crops. Of course, if you have another bed you can make available, I would of course grow the sunchokes or Jerusalem artichokes. They're literally gonna grow like a weed, and if those guys don't make it, then you probably should be a gardener, because even with little care and even with ignoring them a lot, they're gonna produce nice tuberous bulbs that can be eaten, you know, in the winter time when there's not so much fresh foods. Some other crops that can be sown from seed, which is always the best way to save money, although in many cases I recommend getting baby plant starts if you're new into gardening. You know, plants that can be sown from seed easily. A lot of the beans can be grown from seed really easy. You could just go to your local health food store to the bulk bins and buy seeds of beans, because they sell many beans for cooking, but those beans can also be sprouted and grown in your garden so that you could have those same exact beans that you're buying, you know, growing in your yard. Aside from the beans that sprout really easily and quickly, things like the radishes can be seeded really easily, as well as carrots and daikon radishes, some of my favorites, the turnips and rutabagas, all are gonna do great at this time of the year. A part of every garden and what I recommend everybody to do is to compost, compost, compost. Now, it's kind of quite unrealistic at this point for them to produce enough compost to fill the raised bed garden. You know, I think everybody should compost and at least use the compost they make to supplement their garden, especially when bringing in all this soil. And so as we can see here, we got a compost bin with a lot of little flies in there. And you know, this is just a barrel that's basically, they're just dumping the food in. And yes, while this will work, if they did want to do it like this without really doing much else, I would recommend using something called bokashi. And bokashi will help break down this food matter into something that's more usable very quickly with minimal odors. But if they're not wanting to use the bokashi method, then I would recommend, you know, we need to get some aeration in here. So drilling this thing full of holes. And then actually also, you know, it looks like they're putting a lot of food scraps in here, but it doesn't look like they're putting a lot of carbonous waste products. So carbonous waste products is like, you know, the leaves. They got tons of leaves on the ground here. They just need to get raked up and put in here along with the food scraps. So what I would do is I'd probably have a big bucket of leaves, and every time you put food scraps, take actually two big handfuls of leaves. You need to put more leaves than the food scraps and just keep layering it up over and over. And then, you know, when you're done, you'd probably have to dump it all out. You know, I'm not a big fan of this. I'd probably rather, with all this space, I'd rather have a big pallet pile, you know, that I would just be able to stack everything up. I would use this barrel for another use, such as, you know, storing rainwater to collect rainwater off the roof to use in the water to water during the summertime when it's not raining. Hopefully you guys enjoyed this episode learning what I'm recommending to my friend so that she can start growing some food. Whether you're starting a garden now or whether you're gonna start one in the future, you know, hopefully this video is valuable to basically give you the principles that you'll wanna use and do and try to duplicate in your area so that you also be successful gardening. I guess one of the last things I wanna show is here's the cactus fruit here, and it's currently in the flower stage. So it's a nice and beautiful little flower, and they got all little pollen here. So I like to pick off some little pollen. Cactus fruit pollen, it's the bomb. Wow, quite sweet. Once again, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and remember, keep on growing. Here's one of my favorite palms right here. It doesn't look like much now, but believe it or not, this palm is probably at least 5 years old.
No, bitch.
We got a little dog.
Push him away. He's not allowed to dig up the palms.
Banjo. Yup.
So hyper.